Innovation. It happens anytime and everywhere. But the best innovation is supported by an open source ecosystem, driving human and technology advances. Making next-gen technology enterprise-ready starts now. I only got 4 minutes.
One, two, three, go. Tick-tock, tick-tock.
Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome back Vice President of International Marketing at Hortonworks, John Kreisa.
Good morning, good morning. Welcome to day two of DataWorks Summit. It's great to see so many people back here nice and early in the morning. It was a great intro, hard to come up after that, I must say. So it's great to see everybody back here today. Today, we're going to take a little bit of a different shift in terms of the presentations, a little bit more of the roots of DataWorks and Hadoop Summit. Today, we're going to talk a lot about tech innovation, the technology, and the innovation behind the data and what things are driving it forward. So, got a lot of great presentations for you today. I think you really enjoyed this morning, and previewed all of the presentations we're going to have. I think you really enjoy it. So, what I want to do today is start with a poll. So I hope that everybody used their app and took the signal that I gave yesterday in terms of downloading the app, because we're going to use the DataWorks app to do this poll. So if you haven't downloaded it already, maybe you have time to do it right now. If not, we'll do a couple today. So make sure you take the app. If you have it, this poll will appear in your activity stream. So go ahead and give you a second to bring the app up. The first polling question, something nice and easy that I want everybody to try. So, are you using machine learning in your organization? And you'll see these choices within the app, and you'll have a chance to grab those. So I'll just read through them. Are you investigating the potential? So you're just kind of thinking about it within your organization. Have you started using it? You're sort of really at the beginning of the journey with machine learning or artificial intelligence. You're looking at that. Are you really deep in experience? You've been using it for a while. You're already driving value out of machine learning and artificial intelligence, or maybe, just in case, it might not be relevant for you. So I'll give you just a second to answer the poll. We're going to look at the live results here right behind me in just a second, but I want to give people a chance to see that. Should be right at the top of your activity stream. And let's go ahead and see what results we're getting in now. So some people are starting to answer. We need more than two votes, so you guys need to get active here. I know there's more than two people out there using the app, because we've had a couple polls, and there's been, in some cases, hundreds of results. So let's go ahead and get those answers in. And if not, I can always show the answers a little bit later. One is investigating and one is not relevant. So are you guys clicking? Are you seeing it? Somebody down here in front? Having trouble connecting. It's a Wi-Fi issue, okay. Yes, always this case at conferences is the Wi-Fi will let you down. It's letting me down now, too. Hurts. Okay. So, okay, we're moving on, apparently, because they've taken my slide down. So let's keep going. So in order to make it a little bit interesting with our presenters today, I thought we'd get a little bit personal with them. I asked them a couple of questions. I asked them, what was their first data-related job? And then I also asked them, what is just one fun fact? So I thought this would just give us a way to kind of understand a little bit more behind the presenters we're going to have up today. Our first presenter, his first data-related job was with Tata Group. He was a senior officer back in 1996, so a little while ago, 20 years ago or so. And his fun fact is he's been cooking since he was age 10, and he still continues to actively cook. He caters for large groups of 100 or more. So with that, let's invite Sumeet Singh and see what he's got cooking for us today. Sumeet from Yahoo.
Thank you for the introduction,
Thank you.
John.
There you go.
Pleasure. All right, so good morning. You know, I've been doing a lot of talks at this venue for the last 5-6 years. Perhaps my last one in purple. We're officially Verizon as of yesterday, just in case you didn't know. So let's talk Hadoop. So in the last 11 years, you know, Hadoop has been the quintessential cloud platform for Yahoo. And the platform has continuously evolved to meet the new demands or evolving demands as we saw them. And it's this constant shaping of the platform is what has allowed us to stay strong and mature the platform over these years. Right, so what I want to do in the next 10 to 12 minutes is to walk you through how we have shaped this platform and now how we have evolved it to meet new use cases, new demands as they have emerged on the platform. Okay? So just to set context, the platform, the data platform at Yahoo, brings all the producers, data producers and data consumers together across all our businesses, offering a variety of services to them. And it doesn't really matter what the business is. It could be search, advertising, communication, media, or other types of businesses we're in. But they're all brought together on this common platform. And the idea is that we deliver business benefit to these businesses. And then they, in turn, power the consumer experiences that Yahoo is known for. So obviously, we see a lot of diversity in our use cases. Over the years, we've also scaled up the platform fairly nicely, as you will see. And what that has allowed us to do is to bring the marginal cost down for every tenant. Tenant here is a use case or project, either for the existing tenants or for the newcomers who come onto the platform. And the platform has fostered a really good breeding ground for innovation or newer paradigms for processing and managing data as we have evolved it. And it's this evolution which I think is key to the success behind the platform. So let's talk about compute first, because that is the basic unit of work on our platform. So what this chart shows is percentage share of three compute engines we run on our clusters. So all clusters run Tez, Spark, and MapReduce. And this is a chart, a daily sort of compute share over a period of last 17 months. And you can see here that we've been constantly shaping the nature of compute on the platform, moving a lot of workload or share away from MapReduce over to Tez. And most of that comes from Apache Pig for us and Apache Hive. Right, so from almost nothing, it's now nearly 70% of the compute share on the platform, and Spark's pretty consistent as well. So this chart doesn't mean that the compute is not growing. It's just a relative share of these compute engines. So obviously, thousands of hours have gone in both from us and the community to make this a reality. And what this compute shaping does is that it allows us to make better use of the platform. That, in conjunction with a lot of work we have done on the scheduler and capacity management processes, have improved our utilization over the same period. So this is, again, that 17-month period, last 17-month period. And you can see the used capacity across the platform. Now I'm talking about all production and non-production environments collectively on a daily basis. And you can see that from low 40s, 50s, the utilization has improved now to nearly 70s. Storage actually is improving as well from a utilization standpoint. So this is fantastic. This is fantastic for the company. This is fantastic for our customers because they can make better use of the available capacity. Now, Apache Storm is the real-time platform at Yahoo and has been for the last 5-6 years. And early on, a lot of our focus was in scaling Storm clusters, improving the usability for our users. But last year or so has been a lot about what we call as resource-aware scheduler. Right? So we've been constantly in the quest for moving old topologies, old tenants, from the old multi-tenant scheduler over to this new resource-aware scheduler. And that has really come to fruition in the last 7 months, which is what this chart shows you. And as these topologies have migrated from the old multi-tenant scheduler to the resource-aware scheduler, you can see that the compute efficiency, both for CPU cores as well as memory, has continued to improve. So again, we're talking about high 40s, now well into 60s and 50s for both CPU cores and RAM. So again, fantastic for our Storm customers as well as us who operate the platform. Now, there's a lot going on here, but let me explain. So Apache HBase, for a lot of our customers, serves as the glue between batch and real-time worlds. Right? So what you see here is region server throughput from a single multi-tenant cluster. There are about 45 tenants on this cluster, and it does look pretty chaotic. So the question is, well, how do we shape random access on a shared multi-tenant cluster when the workloads vary this much? The other reason why workloads vary this much is because a vast variety of tools, both batch and real-time, are reading and writing into HBase at the same time, right? So what we have done is that we have introduced a concept called region server groups several years ago and been constantly sort of improving that. But when I separate out the tenants and their workloads, now that chart, the same chart, broken down, doesn't look all that chaotic, right? So this is the way we provide course isolation on our HBase clusters by separating out tenants as groups while maintaining the throughput and performance SLAs or latency SLAs for our customers. Right, so pretty key technology for us in terms of bridging the worlds. Of course, no data platform is complete without a comprehensive analytics, warehousing, reporting, or BI solution, whatever you want to call it. And while we use a number of technologies in the analytics space, Apache Hive is really the predominant tech we've been shaping for the last 5 years. We started way back in 2012 with Hive 9, and as you can see over the years, in multiple stages, the evolution of the platform has really been about lowering the latency and improving the performance. Right, so we're now with Hive 1x, moving on to Hive 2x, and you can see that sort of improvement in latency. But just to set things in a better perspective of how that shaping has evolved, I'm going to walk you through some numbers. So this is all the queries, all SQL queries that ran on our clusters last month, right, in May. So about 2 million queries that ran last month. And what I've done here is that created bins of latency. Now, this latency here is pure DAG runtime. There is some start and prep time, which I've not included, just to keep things simple. And you can see that vast majority of our queries, about 75% of them, finish in about a minute. Right? So sweet spot seems to be in that 17-second range when you're processing about 5 million records. Right? So 55% of queries are finishing in that time. Obviously, there are 25% of queries which sort of take minute or minutes, but just to, again, put things in perspective, we're processing 500 million to roughly 16 billion records on an average, each of these queries, right? So which is why it's taking that long. They are different in nature than the generic queries that you experience. And again, the quest here is to push this curve, sort of the bigger bars, towards the right side of you, into that 0 to 10 second range, and we're on our way with in-memory and other techniques. Okay. So, a lot of shaping has happened from a tech standpoint, framework standpoint, but we've also been shaping our infrastructure as demands are evolving. So our infrastructure is fairly generic, We run JBOD servers largely. They're all connected to a network backplane, which is fairly large, supports about 20,000 servers. But what we have done lately is that we've introduced GPU servers, which are connected directly with a high-speed InfiniBand network, 100 gig in this case. And then we've also introduced very high memory servers in the same racks where generic CPU servers live, right? And what this has allowed us to do is that this has allowed us to introduce newer paradigms of processing for large-scale machine learning, for deep learning. And we use node labels extensively to target applications to these specific specialized hardware as they need these processing units or compute power from the clusters. We're perhaps going to use the same node label technique for ultra-low latency analytics as well, or the in-memory analytics I was talking about, just to distinguish the queries from, I would say, the ones that need generic processing versus the ones that need ultra-low-speed processing. And this is how we've evolved our stack to support large-scale machine learning. So most of the components have stayed the same, except the fact that we've introduced a homegrown parameter server that allows us to share the parameters when we distribute learning. So that's a key piece of tech that we have evolved. We've also introduced a number of scalable algorithms on the platform, word2vec, the gradient booster decision trees, things like that. Algorithms that our customers need, right? So we work on scaling those. And there are two specific frameworks we have open sourced in the last 1 to 2 years. One's called Cafe on Spark. The other one's called TensorFlow on Spark. And I encourage you to look at both of them, which sort of highlights our technique of RDMA on InfiniBand for distributed learning or fast learning. Of course, we support notebooks for easy development, experimentation, and sharing. And the models are served via our Elastic Serving Pass, right? So that's the setup here. And over the years, we've also been shaping the user experience, because I think that's fairly important. So we have introduced hosted development UIs. We're pretty much well on our way into self-serve onboarding. Not 100% there, but pretty close. Complete resource transparency, both for tenants and the infrastructure. Complete cost transparency in terms of what it's costing the tenants to run their use cases on the platform. Basic discovery, basic governance, as well as really insightful tools that gives you deeper visibility into what the users are doing on the platform. And many of these tools are actually used by our end users, right? Not just by us. So I believe that these five factors have contributed to the success of our platforms as we have shaped them over the years. The first one, of course, is a platform mindset, right? It requires sustained investment over longer periods of time. You can't expect magic overnight. The other important thing, which actually has contributed to the success of the platform at Yahoo, is that we offer everything on our platform as a service. We don't require our customers to do a lot of setups or installs. There is also a really decent tech ecosystem where different pieces work well together. So there are lots of services at people's disposal. Open source, of course, is big for us. And the mighty shapers in our team, right? So that's also a huge reason. So thank you. You know, I have shared a lot and learned a lot here at this venue, and I hope you do the same. Thank you.
Thank you.
Sumeet.
Thanks very much. All right, so good examples of HBase and Hive at massive scale. In keeping with sort of the tech behind big data and some of the things and technologies, and certainly Yahoo being amongst the earliest of using the technology and using it at a massive scale gives us some great insight there. So we've determined that it was an app issue, not a Wi-Fi issue. So we were localizing the problem, but no small app issue is going to keep Batman down. We're going to make it work. So we'll do maybe a demo or do another poll a little bit later if we can get the app issue fixed. So what I want to do now is bring out two additional presenters, and they're going to give you a demo. So we're going to keep with kind of the tech and the geekiness behind the tech. Our first was an intern writing code at Lucent Technologies. And by his own admission, the fun fact is that code at the time was horrible.
The second person that we'll have up here today was also an intern at Southwest Research and was analyzing pixel data from 3D imaging, so kind of cool. And the fun fact about this particular person is that he's had 3 kids in under 3 years, and therefore has no other fun facts. So that would keep, I'm sure, a very busy home. So let me bring up Joe Witt and George Vetticaden from Hortonworks. There you go. Good luck.
Thanks, Tom.
Thanks.
Hello, everybody. Thank you very much for letting us come out and spend a few minutes talking to you. I want to start by making sure that my friends and colleagues on the East Coast know that there's no chance I'll be dancing or wearing glow sticks. Okay, so we're going to spend a little bit of time here explaining to you, or kind of reminding you of the journey that we've taken really over the last 4 years with this whole data in motion concept in general, because we've presented each year at the summit talking about it. We'll spend a few minutes after that walking through kind of the details of what we mean when we say data in motion. Those of you who have heard quite a few buzzwords over the last few days, I want to make that buzzword land on a technical level. And then we're going to spend the bulk of the time with George showing you in detail something we're very excited about, which is the Streaming Analytics Manager. Okay, so in 2014, George actually came out and gave a keynote presentation where he described how you can use HDP to do kind of real-time visualization of data. Because at that time, there was a big shift happening where people understood what they could do in HDP, specifically to analyze data at scales they really never could before. But they were starting to have much more interest in lower latency analysis. And so that's what George came out and presented. But with all due respect to George, he totally hand-waved how the data gets there in the first place, right? We then, in 2015, came out and described how to do enhance the data as it lands into the cluster. So as it's arriving in, make it better. Enrich it, make it more useful for visualization analysis. Again, still very much waving on how the data gets there in the first place. In 2016, we said, hey, we want to expand that view. We want to help customers and companies get much better at how they collect the data, drive it throughout the enterprise, and deliver it. I, however, hand-waved how you do stream processing. George and I can tell you, are very excited this year that we can come out and tell a truly balanced end-to-end story and solutions for how you can collect, process, visualize, and understand data in motion all the way through. And that's what HDF 3.0 is all about. So, data in motion across the enterprise. It starts at the edge. For some of you, the edge is cool, fun things like planes, trains, and automobiles. For others of you, it's traditional enterprise where you have servers, workstations, laptops, network devices, and so on. For us, it's wherever the data's life cycle begins, right? The first moment that it's created, the first observation. We want to help you command and manage that data all the way through to the next hop, whether that's a regional gateway, whether that's a core data center, whether that's the cloud, full end-to-end processing. There we want to be able to do streaming analytics. We then want to move on to be able to provide powerful visualizations, be able to interact with that data all while it's in motion, all in time for you to extract maximum value from the data. As we all know, data's value can perish over time. And so we want to help you operate on it in time. Okay, so as we do this and as we think about this kind of end-to-end problem, there's a few cross-cutting concerns that we have to make available all the way through the chain. First and foremost, of course, is security, right? The cozy confines of the enterprise where we have fun things like LDAP and Active Directory and Kerberos and other technologies, those aren't necessarily available to us all over the place, right? And so as we think about end-to-end security, we have to be able to kind of shape-shift and form so that we can use the best and most effective techniques all the way throughout there. We also want to be able to make sure that you understand the origin and attribution of every piece of data, everywhere that it comes from, everywhere that it goes, total lineage, not just once it lands in the cluster, but from the very moment it's created to all the systems that use it, understanding latencies and so on. It's a very important part of that story. It's a big piece of the governance story. Finally, a really, really critical part of our story is all about command and control. Right, building these things at scale is very difficult. And specifically, it's difficult because once you get things set up, you as an organization want to make changes. It's not static. At least if you're doing it right, it's not static. You need to be agile. Having a really powerful command and control mechanism to do that is a critical part of the story. Okay, so I'm going to briefly talk about this in the context, kind of set the stage for the demo that George is going to show you. So we have trucks, right? I'm convinced that George's next gig is going to start a trucking company because he thinks about this a lot. So we have these trucks moving around, and we want to be able to gather sensor data coming off of these vehicles. So we use Minify, which is a sub-project of Apache NiFi. We make that available through HDF to do things like acquire the data from a variety of sensors, start to do initial triage and analysis and understand the relative value of that data so we can prioritize it and then use the most effective, most appropriate comms available to us. Maybe that's activating an LTE signal to send out really critical time-sensitive data. Maybe that's buffering it up so that we can send it out via Wi-Fi when that's available for data that's a little bit more time-tolerant. Data then arrives into a more regional or core location, and here we use technologies like Apache NiFi and Apache Kafka to be able to do the routing and enrichment. So we'll do things like geo-enrichment or add in customer reference data, and then make it available, syndicate that data for a wide range of uses, drive it into systems like Hadoop and Spark. And now, very excited to be able to tell you about what we can do with that data while it's still moving, while it's still very fresh and new and fun, through Streaming Analytics Manager. And here, with SAM, we'll be able to do things like windowed-based processing, right? Temporal, spatial correlation, rolling, tumbling windows, be able to do schema-aware processing, which is really critical. And frankly, when I look at what George is going to demonstrate, to me, that's what jumps out as one of the most awesome parts of this. As an app builder, I can really see that and understand how my data evolves. And we're really targeting these app developers, business analysts, and operations teams so that we can help them maximize their individual user experiences necessary for their skill set, but also give them a way to much more easily come together around a unified platform, collaborate, and do a better job than they ever have before. So George, why don't you take some time to show us exactly how this thing works?
Thanks, Joe. Before I start, quick question for you. When was the last time you built a streaming analytics app? I know you build NiFi apps every morning before you wake up or before you eat breakfast, but when was the last Streaming Analytics Manager app you opened?
So I tried it once. It's way too hard. I have much more fun moving files around.
So let me throw it out to the audience. Raise your hands if you think building Streaming Analytics apps has to get easier. All right, so over 50%.
So, also, George, note, hands is a really good way to do a poll.
Oh, OK, got it. So over the next 10 minutes or so, what I want to show you is, with SAM, how building these complex streaming apps has gotten a lot easier. And not just easier, but actually quite fun, right? So let's see how I do with that. So what you're seeing here is the dashboard to Streaming Analytics Manager. So each of these tiles represents an app that a developer has written. So this first one that you see has been running for, it says here, for the last 2 hours or so forth. And before I walk you through how to build one of these stream apps, I want to first talk about the concept of service pools in Streaming Analytics Manager. So when we talk to customers and ask them, hey, what's your biggest challenge that you have today when you're building these streaming apps? The number one answer we get from users is that it's got to be easier to consume these big data services, right? Service discovery, service configuration has to get easier. And our answer to this problem is service pools. So the idea of a service pool is that you tell SAM the location of a cluster manager. So in this case, we're pointing it to Ambari. It's asking me for its credentials. So let me give it the credentials. And what's happening behind the scenes is SAM is talking to Ambari and saying, hey, what are all the big data services you're managing? And what is your configuration for it? And let me import this in. So I'm going to shield the developer away from the complexities of the configuration associated with connecting to Kafka or connecting to HBase and so forth. So what you notice here is we just created a new service pool called Enterprise Data Lake, and it's got 7 big data services. It's got Storm, it's got HDFS, it's got Druid, HBase, and so forth. So now that we've created these services within these service pools, we can create environments. So the idea of an environment here is to pick and choose what services across different service pools that you want to use. So let's go ahead and create a service pool here. We'll call this DataWorks Environment. And in this environment, I'm going to pick from my first cluster, Storm. Let's pick all my data in motion services. So Storm, we'll pick Druid, we'll pick Kafka, Zookeeper, and Ambari Metrics. But then I want my data at rest services coming from a separate cluster. So that Enterprise Data Lake cluster we just imported, I'm going to pick HDFS, and I'm going to go ahead and pick, why not, HBase. Right? So now I've created an environment called DataWorks ENV, that has 7 services that come from 2 different clusters, which is very normal for most of our customers, where you're going to have different clusters within your organization, but your streaming analytics apps needs to talk to those services. So after we've created the service pools in the environments, now the developer can go to town to build streaming
apps. So, George, if I'm a customer that has like a cloud-based cluster and an on-prem cluster, that means I can make one like logical cluster that uses services from both, right?
That's exactly right. I mean, you've heard in day one about this notion of hybrid cloud environments. And so think about now being able to do service discovery and have one environment where you've got services maybe from AWS, and you've got services from HDP that are running locally within your on-prem cluster. That's exactly right. So I'm going to go ahead and create our first app now. We'll call this DataWorks Streaming App. And I'm going to pick the environment that we just created, DataWorks environment. And now I've got an empty canvas for me to start building my applications. The first thing that I want to do is create a stream. So I'm going to drag over the Kafka processor. And let's call this GeoStream. And notice that all of the hairy details of connecting to that Kafka broker cluster, like the Zookeeper host or the Kafka, where the Kafka broker host is running with the ports and so forth, all of that shielded away from the developer. All the developer has to choose is from the dropdown, what are the list of Kafka topics you want to create this stream from? So let's go and pick truck events Avro, and notice what happens. A schema appears on the right-hand side. Streaming apps require schema. Where is the schema coming from? We've integrated this with a new component called the schema registry, which is also part of HDF 3.0. So the notion of a schema registry is I can project a schema on an eventing data source. So in this case, I've got a schema registered for this particular Kafka topic. Okay, so I've got the schema here. So notice you've got geo information. You've got information about the truck and the driver. And I've just created my first stream. Let's go ahead and create another stream so we can do some interesting things. So I'm going to drag over Kafka again. We'll call this the speed stream. And this time, I'm going to pick the truck speed events Avro Kafka topic. Notice speed, driver information, and so forth. And now I've just created 2 streams. So the first thing that I want to do is I want to be able to join these streams in real time, right? So I've got the speed stream from one sensor, GeoStream from another sensor. I want to be able to join and marry those two. So I'm going to go ahead and drag the join processor and connect my GeoStream into the join and my speed stream into the join. And so as part of the configuring the join, I'm saying, OK, join the first stream, join on driver ID, do an inner type of join. On the second stream, driver ID, and create and do this join across, wait for 3 seconds. And this is for the case, which is very applicable in the real world, not all sensors are created equal. Some sensor might have maybe a three second lag compared to my geo sensor and so forth. So we're adjusting that. And then we're saying, OK, join all the fields. So notice what's happening, right? So we can see on the left-hand side the 2 streams. And now on the right-hand side, after we've done the join, we see both speed and we see the geolocation information. So Joe, when I show this to customers, the one thing that really excites them is the simplicity of being able to see the schema on the left and the right for every component. It's pretty cool. What do you think?
That makes sense. I'm a very visual guy. This is exactly the kind of thing that would make it easy for me to build stream apps as well.
So next time, maybe you won't move files around, right?
Maybe.
All right. So after we join, let's now filter on the stream for events of interest. So I'm going to drag over the rule processor, connect it to my join, and we'll call this filter. And let's add a new rule that says violation event. And we're going to define this rule as for event type that does not equal normal, those are the events that I'm interested in. I've just added my rule, and now I filtered the stream to events that I'm interested in. So the next thing I want to do is I want to calculate the average speed of a driver over a 3-minute interval. Right? So what I'm going to do is I'm going to now drag over the aggregate processor, connect it to my filter stream. And as part of this window that we're creating of 3 minutes, what do you want to group on? Well, I want to group on all the events associated with the driver. So group on driver ID, driver name, and also as well as the route. And what's the window that you want to create? Let's do 3 minutes, because we want to calculate the speed over 3 minutes. We'll do processing time. And what do you want to do at the end of this window? Well, we've got a speed, and I want to essentially calculate the average. So notice now the schema on the right-hand side captures the driver information and now the average speed over that 3 minute. Okay? So you guys are starting to get the idea. I'm going to quickly move over to a kind of a full-fledged app that I've already built and continue the flow. Right? So now that I've calculated the average speed, I wanted to detect speeding drivers. So I've added another rule that says, hey, if the average speed of a driver is over 80 miles an hour, then those are the events that I'm interested in. And from there, I can push those speeding alerts into another application where maybe it's a radio dispatch where we call the driver and tell them to slow down. Or we can stream it into a dashboard. So notice that we have a Druid processor where we can essentially stream things into a Druid OLAP queue where business analysts can create dashboards on it. So in this case, every speeding alert is being sent to an alert speeding driver's queue. So what do we just do? We connected two streams, we joined those streams together, we filter on events that we're interested in, we did aggregations over windows of time, and then we were able to alert and do notifications. That's prescriptive analytics at work, right, without really writing any code. The next flow I want to walk you through is that bottom half of that flow. So my data science team has built this awesome model that can predict if a driver is going to commit a violation, right? And so what Streaming Analytics Manager exposes is a model registry. So that data science person can export that model he's built into things like PMML, put it into the model registry, and then the developer can essentially score events against that model that he's imported into the model registry. And so notice that we've got a PMML processor in here, where it takes a number of features and it outputs if the driver is going to commit a violation. But the problem is, you can't just feed an event, a raw event, into a model. That model requires features such as weather information, how many hours did that driver drive the previous week, HR information about the driver, if he's certified or not. So notice that before we can essentially call that PMML prediction processor, we're doing enrichments in real time. So we've essentially, in this part, we're enriching in parallel using what's known as a split join pattern. So in this first enrichment, we're essentially talking to HBase and saying, hey, for this driver that's coming in, what's his wage plan and certification? And notice now the output of that schema has those enriched values. The second enrichment we're doing is we're gathering information about timesheet information about the driver that captures how many miles, how many hours that he drove. And then the last one is weather information. We got the lat long that comes in. We call weather.com service API to actually figure out if it's foggy, if it's rainy, or if it's snowing, and so forth. And so now we were able to now join those three parallel streams together. We've got all the inputs for our model. And then the result of that model, we can say, hey, if the model spits out that this driver is going to commit a violation, right, the violation predicted output value equals yes, then stream that into a dashboard. Okay? All of this prescriptive analytics, predictive analytics that I just walked you through without a single line of code. Okay? Once that's deployed, what we want to do is now have the business analyst immediately access that stream and to be able to ask questions. So Streaming Analytics Manager not only gives you tooling for the developer, but also for the business analyst as well. Right? So in here, we're going to the dashboard view. And we're going to say the question he wants to ask is how many violations were predicted by the model over the last hour. So I'm going to go ahead and go to where my cubes are. And notice these are all the cubes that I'm streaming data into, the speeding alerts, the predictions, and so forth. I'm going to pick the prediction queue. And this exploration tool, which is powered by Superset, has over 30 plus visualizations. So I'm going to pick a visualization called Big Number. Over the last hour, how many violations were predicted? 6 violations were predicted. Well, let me drill down. Who are these drivers that the model is predicting for? So let me change the visualization to a word cloud, change my dimension to driver name. This is Joe.
Yeah, that makes sense.
Okay. And so if you want to drill further, let me see, where in what routes is the model predicting these violations? Let me change it to another visualization. This is my personal favorite, Sunburst. And I'm going to now roll up on driver as well as the route. And again, keep in mind, this is streaming data that immediately we're getting a glimpse of as Sam is streaming into it. And notice here, Joe, two of those violations, and it's across Peoria to Cedar Rapids, and then the other violation is occurring between Springfield.
But right? Those are just predictions. They could be totally inaccurate.
So all of these can be essentially added to dashboards, and here's what a real-world dashboard would look like, right? So the first row of visualizations is around the speeding alerts cube. Remember the aggregations over windows of time. And the second row is all about the predictions that our data scientist team has built in terms of the outputs of the models, right? So netting it out, Streaming Analytics Manager for the developer, an IDE where he doesn't have to write a lot of code, for the operations teams, for service pools and environments, service discovery, and then also for the business analysts to be able to ask questions of the stream immediately.
Great. Thanks, George.
Yep.
Again, one of the things that I really love about all the stuff that George just showed is what that does for us to collaborate between these different actors. So we have a pretty important end-to-end vision here about how we're going to bring these things together. I'll leave you with, think about the fact that your enterprise is not some big, cool cluster of a distributed system. It is one big, logical, distributed computing system, and we want to help you drive that end-to-end to maximize the value of data all the way through. Again, we do that through providing solutions all the way through for flow management, stream processing, and enterprise services that bring all that together semantically and through the registries and through a deployment experience that helps you. Thank you all very much for your time.
Thanks, guys.
Thank you.
Thanks. Very cool. All right, so now we've seen HBase and Hive at massive scale. We've seen some streaming data, live demo built. I think if somebody's driving a truck at 80 miles per hour, I'd be much more concerned. We need to lower that number. I think that's too high of a threshold. So anyway, great demo there. So now, in keeping again with our technology and kind of the technology behind the data and what's going on, we're going to bring out our next presenter, and I think this is a very good presentation. This is an old colleague of mine, so really happy to bring him out. His first job was back at Arthur Andersen in 1991. He's old, like me, and he wrote I/O code for an IDMR database. So some of you may remember that. Fun fact, though, and you'll know as soon as you see him, he played basketball at Coe College, and he was actually an All-American two years in a row. So very excited to bring out the Dean of Big Data, Bill Schmarzo.
Thanks, John. Good morning. I wish it was 91 when I was at Arthur Andersen. It was more like 81. So, I'm one of these old school people. As the CTO at Dell EMC's big data consulting practice, I spend literally all of my time on the road working with customers. And it is truly the single best job in the industry. I have the best job in the industry because I get a chance to work firsthand with customers. I get to help them through the process of ideation and visioning and design all the way through implementation, operationalization, and adoption. I've even written a couple of really, really boring books that talks about what we've learned as we've gone through these processes. So lots of hands-on practitioner experience. I get to complement that, though, with I also teach at the University of San Francisco School of Management. I teach a class called the Big Data MBA. And the underlying premise behind that class is how do we teach tomorrow's business leaders to embrace analytics as a business discipline? How do we get business people to think like a data scientist? And you can tell that I work at a university because this is a research paper we just finished on how to determine the economic value of data. And you can see the title is like really, really long because research papers are supposed to have really, really insanely long titles. And it's like 30 pages long. And if you think my books are boring, try getting through this baby. So with that as background, what I want to do today is I want to give you five questions. Five questions that I want you to contemplate, not only as you spend the rest of your time at the summit here, but questions that I want you to take back to your business. Questions that you can use as to fuel conversations with your colleagues and your management team. about how to frame this big data conversation. So get your pens and paper ready, or your notebooks, whatever you've got. Let's go through these five questions. Question number one, probably the single most important question I'm going to ask today, which is how effective is your organization at leveraging data and analytics to power your business models? How effective is your organization at leveraging data and analytics? Most organizations today struggle with this question. They find themselves stuck in the monitoring phase. They're using data and analytics to tell them what happened. Reports and dashboards, hey, they look great. It's a great foundation. But you've got to go beyond that. You have to move the organization from using data to report on what happened. You have to look at the data to figure out and try to predict what's likely to happen, to prescribe actions of what I'm going to do, and ultimately to monetize. But you don't monetize the data. You're going to monetize the insights that come from the data, insights about your customers, your products, your operations, to identify white spaces in the marketplace, unmet customer and market needs, where you can create new products and new services, new pricing, new bundle, new markets, new channels, new partners. How effective is your organization at leveraging data and analytics to power the business? The conversation is about the business, which leads us to this second point. Do you understand your organization's key business initiatives and how they will benefit from big data? Key business initiative. What is your business? What is your business trying to accomplish over the next 9 to 12 months? It might be customer acquisition or retention. If you're in a hospital, it might be reducing readmissions or improving quality of care. If you're in the IoT space, it might be around predictive maintenance or demand forecasting or asset utilization. You must understand what the business is trying to accomplish if you want to drive business value with big data. And you need to think about, as you go through that process of contemplating how I'm going to use big data to drive value, I need to understand the use cases that support my business initiative. I need to understand the business stakeholders, that is, who are the business people, the business functions who either impact or are impacted by that business initiative, and then the secret sauce. The secret sauce to everything that we do with our customers is around decisions. It is around decisions that we can link the business users and the data scientists. The business users who we can train to think like a data scientist, and the data scientists who can actually help them to make better decisions. What is data science? Data science is about identifying those variables and metrics that might be better predictors of performance. Period. That's all it is. Get the business stakeholders engaged to brainstorm the variables and metrics that might be better predictors of performance, and the data scientists will tell you which ones actually are. By the way, really key word there, the word might. As an organization, if you do not have enough might moments, you'll never have any breakthrough moments. Question number three, do you have business stakeholder active participation in setting your use case roadmap? I'm not talking about they come and you present to them and you interview them. I'm talking about not just being on the boat, but being at the front of the boat, pointing out which direction to go. Active involvement from day one. This is about driving value for them, right? So it's first about the business and then bringing them in to help envision those variables and metrics that might be better predictors of performance, to get them to think like a data scientist, to drive those decisions. And finally, two things that organizations do really poorly. Watch my language, very poorly. Number one, they don't know how to prioritize. Number two, they don't know how to focus. If you can't prioritize and you can't focus, you're gonna end up pick technology. You're not gonna end, if you try to solve everything, you'll end up solving nothing. Number four, my favorite topic. If you follow me on Twitter, you know I've been blithering about this now for the last month or so. Do you understand the economic value of your data? Do you understand the economic value of your data and how that affects or impacts your technology and business investments? Economic value of data. With the research we just finished at USF, we looked at it, and our research told us that the traditional accounting approach of trying to determine the economic value of data was insufficient. Trying to value data based on what you paid for totally missed how valuable that data could be. So instead of looking at the economic value of data from an accounting GAAP perspective. We looked at it from an economics, think multiplier effect, think marginal propensity to consume, and from a data science perspective. We looked at the value of data, not value in exchange, as Adam Smith talked about, but instead as value in use. And by the way, this phrase, data as a new oil, cute, but totally misses it. Let me give you something that builds on that. Imagine if you had a single barrel of oil, and that barrel of oil could be used across an infinite number of vehicles, and it never depleted. That's data. You have nothing else in your company, on your balance sheet, in your financial statements that act and behave like that. Organizations don't know how to value it. And those organizations that figure out how to leverage the economic potential data science value of the data are the ones who are going to get the most value out of it. Question number five, last question before I run out of time and they yank me off the stage. Do you understand how data science disrupts business models and disintermediates customer relationships? At the end of the day, this is how businesses survive long term. Disrupt business models. It's not about technology, it's about business models. And how do you disintermediate customer relationships, especially those of your competitors? How do you steal them away? To do that, you need to think about digital transformation, which is how am I going to take this wealth of data that I have available to me, and how am I going to integrate it in to my physical processes and physical products? I guess I have one more question. Do I? Come on. Yes, I don't. The fun question I wanted to ask, and I'm going to give you to you right here anyway, so I got 1 minute to go, is do you know how to create a platform, an environment that allows you to exploit the economic value of your data, that drives collaboration between the business and the stakeholders and looks to operationalize that? So you got a bonus question here, the sixth one. So take these 5 points, use this as the frame. And one last point. Before I walked in here, I heard somebody talking outside that they were very frustrated with the conference. They came here with 100 questions, and they've heard 5 to 7 answers to every one of those questions. What do you do? Well, let's back up. Let's start with these 5 questions. Let's frame the conversation around these 5 questions. And let's make sure that we're using the technology, not because we're infatuated with the 3 V's of big data. No business executive I've ever talked to gives a holy hoot about the 3 V's of big data. What they care about are the 4 M's of big data. Make me more money. Thank you for your time. Come see me at the booth.
All right. Thanks. All right. Very entertaining. Thank you, Bill. the 4 M's, now we'll hear that. Make me more money. So let's transition to our next presenter. And this presenter also started a similar way to Bill, actually. Started way back when at Interbase doing a database kernel development. So way back when, if those of you who remember Interbase. And the fun fact for this gentleman is that he loves running and hiking. So he's very active and getting out there, getting outside. Of course, being in California, it's a great place to do that. So without further ado, Girish Mundada, our next presenter. Please come up. Join me in welcoming. Thank you.
Great. Good morning. What a great day to be here with you on behalf of Hewlett Packard Enterprise. Very happy to be here. Also feel very fortunate to live in Silicon Valley for about 30 years building database kernels. Bill mentioned Interbase, which is now Firebird. Also worked on Postgres for many, many years. But you know what? I feel very fortunate. I live in a time when databases are probably the most exciting they've ever been in the last 30 years. And let's look at why, right? Let me do a simple poll. How many of you have used Facebook? Just a show of hands. Okay. How many of you are using it now? All right, wake up. So let me ask you another question, right? How many of you have bought anything from Facebook? One hand. Okay, what does that tell you? This is a company that's worth $430 some billion this morning, and they make money out of thin air selling nothing. And that's really what's most exciting about this. People are figuring out ways to profit from data, not just monetary profit, all kinds of profits, right? And you guys, I'm sure, have seen many, many examples in the last 2 days, and I'm sure you'll see many more in the next 2 or 3 days from your colleagues from the community that's going to show you some innovative use cases. And why is that important? Today, the theme is about enterprise readiness for Hadoop. It's about transformation of the industry, right? And now, the average enterprise, which is not the smart people like you in the room here who have been living Hadoop, breathing Hadoop for years, the average enterprise wants to do it too. They want to do big data. And unfortunately, for most enterprises, big data is not something they can just drop in, right? It's not greenfield for them. So if you look at the average enterprise, the companies that we talk to, they have the traditional OLTP databases, the traditional OLTP application, operational applications. They also have the traditional warehouses. And now they have to add big data into it for specific use cases. They cannot rip and replace like some of these new age startups that you represent. Not all of you, but whoever represents new age startups. And the brave ones within them have moved into streaming, artificial intelligence, which itself has many, many sub-pieces to it. And we're also seeing a convergence of the mega trends, like the artificial intelligence, the cloud, and some of the advanced ones are going there. Now, when I come to these conferences, right, I've been going to these conferences, big data conferences, for many, many years. If you notice, the theme today is transformation, transforming the industry. And honestly, I believe big data is transforming the industry, right, in a very significant way. And many of you believe it's going to take over the world. It's really contagious. I mean, that excitement level is very contagious. Big data is going to take over the world. So let me share with you a story. Now, I'm old, quite old, actually. And so this is based on my lifetime, right? Years ago, I think John mentioned, I used to work on Postgres 30 years ago. I was one of the folks who wrote kernel code for Postgres many, many years. And back then, just like many of us, I believed Postgres is going to take over the world. Open source database, one of the early open source things, we're going to take over the world. Boy, was I wrong, right? Yes, Postgres did actually make a huge impact. Yes, things moved along with Postgres. But then there are three things that I learned over the 30 years that I would like to share with you and hope you'll agree with them. And the three specific things, right? First, databases never finish. Just when you think databases are done, the next business problem is there, the next set of technologies, the next set of ways of doing things are there. The second important thing you will see is there are multiple ways to solve the same problem. There is no right or wrong answer, right? These trends are merging. So as an example, if you think of the world of OLTP and warehouses, there are new technologies now which basically combine. So if you look at the SAP world as an example, or if you look at some of the other players, they have combined OLTP and analytics into one. You don't need ETL anymore, as an example. That is now bleeding into the big data community. And the big data guys are going backwards and fixing some of the EDW optimization. So that's how optimizations happen. And third, what you'll find is for the average enterprise, It really is the right set of tools for the right job. There is no right and wrong answer. So you have to, what you choose really depends on three things. What's your business problem? How much money do you have? And how much time do you have? And within that context, you have to pick from this continuum of things. So at Hewlett Packard, I'm responsible for driving a set of technologies across this entire continuum. We have a series of solutions across this continuum. And we do see data as a continuum, truly. Our strategy is very simple. We provide the best infrastructure in the industry. That's what we want to specialize in. We want to work with the best of breed software partners that finish the next stack. And then every industry, every use case has a specialized set of system integrators, services providers. We want to partner with them and bring solutions to market. And Hadoop is one of them. If you look at the other continuum, for example, in the world of HANA, SAP HANA, we power about 50% of the world's HANA infrastructure today. Our infrastructure space for artificial intelligence and for deep learning, we do a lot of work with the GPU providers, and we build some really cutting-edge infrastructure for that. But today is all about Hadoop. We're going to talk about Hadoop, right? So now, within that context, let's look at outside of this community, which is Hadoop specialists, which know Hadoop quite well, what does an average enterprise's Hadoop journey or big data journey look like? Here's what happens. Most companies will have an ERP database, some ERP application, talking to a bunch of smaller databases. You have a customer record in three different applications. You want to merge it, and then you build a warehouse. That's typically how this evolved over years and years. You created a warehouse. And the warehouse has all the source of truth. And then one day, a CMO or some line of business within a company comes and says, can you please go ahead and look at these tweets? There are these companies talking to me. I went to this big data conference somewhere. They were doing cool stuff. And they were analyzing tweets. Can you analyze tweets and tell me what my customers are telling me? So the IT department will go and try to do it with the tools they know. So they'll take the tweets, they'll put it next to their warehouse, and try to solve this problem. And obviously, as they try to do that, the first application might work, the first use case might work. And very soon as the other departments know that this is happening, they come up with more use cases saying, go do this. And obviously, the existing setup doesn't work. So what do? The IT department will then go look in the industry and say, you know what? There is this cool thing called Hadoop. Let me put this thing called Hadoop. So they'll set up a Hadoop data lake. And their hope is to take the existing use cases that they have, move them over to this Hadoop data lake, because they actually believe Hadoop is the new data warehouse, and which it is, by the way. And they're hoping that they can simply do what they did with the other database tools. And very quickly, they realize Hadoop is a lot more complex than the traditional mature tools. They've had 30 years to mature. Of course, this is all fixable, right? In fact, you see an entire ecosystem of vendors here who are trying to solve this problem, right? But as I speak to customers on a regular basis, there are really three key trends that we see in the enterprise grade readiness space, right? And let's look at the common problems that I hear from customers. First, Hadoop infrastructure can get very complex. And getting high performance of that is not easy, especially as workloads grow. There is really no right or wrong answer to figure out what performance should you expect from a Hadoop cluster. We go into customer accounts that have been there for 5, 6, 10 years. Our engineers look at it and they say, oops, this basic setup is wrong. It's very common. The second thing, and I'm sure you guys know, you're probably the most prized possession in the industry at the moment, right? Hadoop skill sets are very, very hard to find. Even for the Silicon Valley companies, let alone the average enterprise in Timbuktu. And third, Hadoop has come a long way from where it was 10 years ago. I've been following Hadoop 10 years. HP has been working with the Hadoop community for about 10 years now. If you just look at the growth we have had over the last 1 year in the technology improvements, it's massive. If you look at the amount of ecosystem that you have, every year that the show gets bigger and bigger. And that proves my point. The average enterprise has to put together tool sets from 10 different companies to build what they need to make the system work. So somebody has to do this integration. And it truly takes a village to grow a child. Not to say Hadoop is a child, but it truly is a ecosystem efforts of many, many, many different vendors working together. And this is where Hewlett Packard Enterprise comes in. Right? So what we do is really, we do three things. We call our solution Enterprise Grade Hadoop. It's a packaged offering that has three different key pieces that you see in the green boxes. First, we bring together a proven infrastructure that we have tested with many different components of the Hadoop ecosystem. Second, we bring in the software ecosystem of not just the Hadoop, but the ecosystem products that you need. And finally, we bring together with our partners a set of services that we need. So we work with Hortonworks regularly to bring their services, our services. And the services that most average enterprises need are beyond just Hadoop. They have to integrate it with their existing environment with other tool sets. So you need a larger ecosystem of service partners to bring all of that together. One key thing I wanted to point out to you guys, where our strategy fundamentally differs from some of the ecosystem vendors. We truly believe in an open Hadoop ecosystem. We have not created a proprietary Hadoop fork. We will not create one, right? So we work with the standard distributions of Hadoop, all the major distributions of Hadoop. We bring them to market. We tune our hardware infrastructure for that. The other thing we do also differently is we believe in choice. And that's why we don't pick a side with one Hadoop vendor or other. There's a right tool for the right job. That's always been our message. And we also certify with the open ecosystem tools. But what we do differently is, once we have identified a set of bundles that work together very well, then we take that, we package it, and we make sure that it can be repeated customer after customer, account after account, because then we can take the risk out of implementations. So within that context, I wanted to show you our solutions. We have two solutions. Our solution is called Enterprise Grade Hadoop. We have an edition called Standard Edition. This is what you guys are normally used to, where your storage and compute are in the same box. And many of you are familiar with this setup. But then we also have a differentiated solution, which we call Elastic Grade Hadoop. You heard Sumeet mention about it. Yahoo is doing this, tagging and separating. So in this model, we allow you to use high-density servers for storage. We also allow you to separate storage and compute. There are certain kind of workloads like high memory workload, GPU workloads that make sense to separate them. We bundle all of this. And we sell a lot of these globally. And as you perhaps are aware, Hewlett Packard Enterprise is one of the largest vendors for Hadoop infrastructure today in the market. We have a very close working relationship with Hortonworks over the years. Our engineering teams, our go-to-market teams work very closely together. And we keep up to date with their releases. We create our infrastructure to match those releases. So today, I'm very happy to announce this new offering that we have in the market. It's on the show floor. About 20 people from both our organizations have been working on it for the last 3 months plus. You've already heard a lot of news about LLAP. Sumeet mentioned it in the Yahoo presentation. We were one of the first ones to actually have a commercial offering that's optimized around it. We also have some very interesting benchmarks. These benchmarks are very, very promising. Come have a look at our booth. We can share with you some data. And with that, I want to thank you and have a great rest of the show. Thank you.
All right. Thank you, Girish. Take that, shake the hand, very good. All right, so a little bit about some of the technology from HP and some of the use cases that they're seeing. So for our next presenter, I'll go with his data job. His first data job's interesting. Back at Sprint in 1994, he worked at Sprint and created their first relational database setup for customer marketing. So way back in 1994, probably we all got some emails related to Sprint, and we can thank our next presenter. The fun fact, huge baseball fan. massive baseball fan, and is on a quest to visit and see a game at every single Major League Baseball park. So he has six more to go, and we wish him well in his quest. So let's bring up our next presenter, Kevin McGinnis from Pinsight Media. Kevin? This and that.
Thanks, Sean. Good morning. Show of hands, any San Francisco Giant fans in the audience? Ooh, tough crowd then. I was just thinking last night about the fun fact portion of this thing, that my trip to AT&T Park was actually for a San Francisco Giants World Series win, but none of you really care, so we'll just move on from that. As John said, I am the CEO of Pinsight Media. For those of you who don't know about Pinsight Media, we are a premium source for actionable insights using first-party carrier data. And we use that data to actually power more intelligent business decisions and help brands and businesses better understand who their real consumers are and what their real behaviors are. And when they asked me to give this presentation, I'll admit, a little confession, I was very concerned because they said, you're going to be at DataWorks giving a keynote presentation. And I thought, well, I'm not an engineer, I'm not a data scientist. And if they ask me to talk about the technology stack, we're going to have a real problem. They said, no, calm down, Kevin. Actually, what we want you to do is we want you to explain how your business and how the data that you have in your business is either transforming your company or transforming your industry. And I thought, that's pretty easy. I think we can talk about that. So what I want to do this morning is I want to talk through really a couple different things. One, I want to talk about the big industry, the evolution of our industry, and how that's created our vision and our view of how we need to approach the market. Talk a little bit about how that evolution has really created a problem for our customers that we are solving for them. And then talk about the data itself. Talk about the data set, how it's different than other data sets that are out there, and how we see that really impacting those industries and being, quite honestly, very transformative to the available data sets that are out there for those industries today. And then want to show you a brief demonstration of the data at work, and I think that really kind of brings it to light and helps you understand what we're talking about. So the image that you see behind me is actually one of the most, I think, telling things to talk about the evolution of mobile. Mobile is ubiquitous. I'm sure everybody here has a mobile phone with them, and I think you know, it's something that we never leave behind. It's something that we use every day in our lives. And I think the speed at which that has happened surprises some people when you look back on what's happened in the industry. So what you see is, in 2005, this is a picture from the Vatican, from St. Peter's Square, and it was the announcement of Pope Benedict. You see no mobile phones. You see the exact same picture in 2013 for the announcement of Pope Francis, and you see everyone, this amazes me, you see everyone watching a live event through a little screen that they've put in front of their face. If you've ever been to a Little League baseball game, you see the same phenomenon there as well. And I think this really speaks to what has started to happen. This ubiquity has really kind of transformed behaviors and transformed society in a very meaningful way. And by that, I mean we communicate, we navigate, we shop, we work out, we entertain ourselves. It's really gone from being a communications device to being a channel for content to now it's a full-blown utility. And 2013 happened to be the same year that we realized that that utility and that function that was coming from mobile devices was actually an opportunity for us to take all of this data that is generated through the network and actually create an opportunity, create an answer for a problem that's out there. So you could say we had a solution looking for a problem, but the reality is the problem was staring us right in the face, and that's what I'm here to talk about. The idea of the 8-second rule. Show of hands, anybody heard of the 8-second rule? All right, good. So in 2015, Time Magazine published an article about a study that Microsoft had done where they had actually researched and analyzed the attention span of humans. And what they came back and concluded was the attention span is now 8 seconds. That is not very long. I think Facebook just said something about having a 3-second attention span, but that's for people who still use Facebook. The honest problem with this is that if you think about attention spans, 8 seconds is actually less time than the average goldfish. So we as a human species have let this ubiquity of mobile, the distraction, the clutter of what happens in the,
the digital world and the mobile world actually make us less effective from an attention span perspective than a fish. And that creates a tremendous challenge for our customers. Because if you think about it, there is now a finite window in which you can understand consumer behavior, connect with your user, and engage them in a meaningful way. And that's a real problem. For us, that problem, that technology, that underlying technology that created some of this situation, we feel like is actually part of the answer to the problem. And so I really want to walk you through what that data set looks like and what we see when we look at mobile data and how it's different than the data that's out there in the ecosystem today. So the first way that it's very different is actually it's on 24/7. It's always fresh. Always fluid and it's ever changing, which is extremely important when you think about this 8-second attention span opportunity. Now, the data sets themselves, just to give you a quick tutorial on what we actually pull in, we pull in about 30 different data sets from across the mobile domain in the mobile ecosystem. Some of it's application data, some of it's CRM data, demographic data, those types of things. But the two major data sources that are impacted by this 24/7 situation are location data. So we see about 600 events per day per device that's on the network. And that's quite different than what you see in the application domain, where it's usually 5 to 25 times per day per device or per user. And we also see behavioral information. We see what people are actually doing on the network. And if it's not encrypted, we can see the URI strings, we see domains, we see IP ranges, we see really what people are doing, where they're going, what applications they're using, and those types of things. The second way that the data is very different is the fact that it's personalized. It's very different for every user. And by that, it's as unique as the fingerprint of the person who's using it. So for me, you see me up here on the stage today as a CEO. But if you were to look behind my lock screen, or if you were to look at the browser on my phone, you would see that I'm a single father of teenage girls, that as John said, I'm a huge sports fan. I'm a season ticket holder to the Kansas City Royals and the Kansas Jayhawks. You would also see that the applications I use on my phone, I'm actually learning a language using an application on my phone, Duolingo. I'm a Spotify user multiple times a day. I use my phone to work out using MapMyFitness. And so there's a lot of insights that you can glean from looking at the mobile traffic and understanding what someone might be doing with their device. Another way that it's very different is it's extremely relevant. Can you think of another device that is more contextually aware all the time than the mobile phone? The idea of capturing the right person, the right place, the right time is only possible in the mobile domain. And then finally, the idea that this data is extremely actionable and insightful. It's really the only way that businesses and brands can understand the intent to engage of their consumers and really understand that moment when they're ready to make a purchase decision, to stop by a location, or to do any other type of engagement that would be meaningful for that business. And it's extremely transformative in this actionable state for quite a few industries. And so the insights that are derived from mobile data have the opportunity to create insights to help brands better understand their creative, the messaging that they need to provide to their consumers, how they need to talk to them in a moment and create personalized messaging. It has the opportunity to drive tremendous change for businesses to make more intelligent decisions about where they need to locate retail, what they need to do as it relates to the physical structure of their business, and how they need to structure maybe displays in their stores and do those types of things. And then finally, it has the ability for us to drive better experiences for consumers across the board, whether it's in mobile or elsewhere, understanding who they are from a better perspective. Now, what I want to do is I want to show you a video that we've created that really demonstrates the power of this data. And what you see behind me is a sky view of Kansas City. We had one of our employees, the product manager for this, that has actually volunteered to let us actually look at the difference between his commute to work using network data and his commute to work using application data. So we'll just call this employee Adam. And I'll show you Adam's commute to work. And I think it demonstrates the power of what we're talking about here. The blue dots that you will see are the times that we see Adam on the network. And as we see Adam every 2.5 minutes on his commute, you can see that we see him quite frequently. If you were to look at application data, which you see much less, we would only see his origination and his destination point. So you have to use probabilistic techniques to determine what's the most likely route he would take, and that's the red line. So as Adam arrives to work, and you pull back and you look at the differences, it might not seem dramatic to you. But if you're thinking about this as a retailer who's trying to determine where they need to open or close a location, understanding where your consumers are really going is a very important thing. This is a 10 to 20 year investment that you might make. If you're an out-of-home marketer trying to put your message in front of a consumer, understanding where they're going and understanding who's actually in that car is a very different equation than what's available today, which is really car counts, census counts, and understanding some very basic things. We know who's in the vehicle, we know the origination and destination catchment areas, and we can tell you where to properly put that message and what message you need to put out there. And if you're just a marketer in general, the idea of understanding that Adam has probably driven by a Starbucks in the morning and not a Dunkin' Donuts, or he's probably driving by a Home Depot on his way home and not a Lowe's, those are extremely critical decisions to help businesses better and more efficiently spend their money. So all of this, really the way to summarize, I think, what's happening for all of these industries that are learning about data sources and learning about new ways to use data, is this Rupert Murdoch quote. And the idea that it's not about the big beating the small anymore, it's about the fast beating the slow. And so for us, the ability to process these large sets of data faster and better is extremely important, not just for our business, but for all of the industries that we're serving today. And so at the end of the day, what we like to say is it's really not about the data, even though we are a data company. When we talk to our customers and we face the market, and I think it's important for everyone who works in this domain to keep this in mind, it's really not about the data. It's really about saying, well, we're data-fueled, but we're insights-driven. Thank you very much for giving me more than 8 seconds of your time. Thank you.
Kevin.
Thank you, Kevin. Sir.
Thank you.
That was a pretty cool demonstration, and it gives you a lot to think about there in terms of how retailers need to think about where they place their stores and things. So it's very interesting. So for our next presenter, again, we're going to go back to our questions on first data job. Here, first data job was working on data warehousing for go-to-market at Sun Microsystems. That's the official first data job. The unofficial job that I got here was counting the weight of ice cream scoops at a Häagen-Dazs store. So really appreciated the working at the store. In terms of fun fact for our next presenter, our next presenter is an avid hiker, likes to spend time outdoors, also an avid reader. So managed to find a way to combine those two things together, and most recently hiked the Inca Trail up to Machu Picchu, carrying a copy of Wuthering Heights in the backpack. So that's, combining both of those two likes. Anyway, let me bring up our next presenter, Donna Perlich from Pentaho. Donna?
You've got their Wuthering Heights in. Good morning. The Wuthering Heights is a great story that my sisters look at me and go, is she really reading Wuthering Heights? The answer is yes. So, fun facts. I'm really excited to be here and talk to you guys about, I've been at these conferences for probably the past 4 to 5 years. But it's great to be here and talk about what's kind of coming next. And it was really fascinating to listen to previous presenter because a lot of similarities in terms of what we're doing with data and what kind of value we're getting from it. So I'm going to talk about IoT, but I'm also going to talk about how the context of what all of us in this room are doing right now with big data is really what's going to drive the value in IoT. And in fact, if we don't look at them in a similar way, we may not be very successful at that. So a McKinsey study on IoT talks about how really 40% of the potential value for IoT is in the systems being able to interoperate. And I think we've seen that, you know, the great presentation from the Hortonworks team on the work they're doing. If things that are capturing data at the edge go into a fog layer, and at some point there's an insight out there, if all of these systems can't interoperate, it's going to be very difficult to be successful in terms of the technology. The other piece of that is when you bring in the data, you get another 20% value. So that was another thing that McKinsey references in their studies, is that you have to bring in the data to make it, to kind of up the ante on that value. This one I won't, we've all seen that curve that we've been looking at for the last 4 to 5 years that shows how fast data is growing. The interesting thing is most of the data that's being collected isn't really going to be used and not fully exploited. A great example of that is an oil rig has something like 30,000 sensors on it. But if you look at how much value is being generated from that data, only about 1% today of that sensor data is actually being used for anything that derives value. And it's going to change the way we think about the competitive nature of business and really kind of create new business models, not just transform our existing businesses, but transform certain industries, you know, transportation as a service, those types of things. And I'll talk a little bit about some of the customers that Pentaho's seeing, but also just in general, some kind of interesting transformational business models that are emerging. And we talked about, I think there's a reference to planes, trains, and automobiles. And in manufacturing, energy, those are the areas that we're seeing most of the growth in terms of an emerging use cases in IoT. But it's going to arise across all the verticals. So the real question is, who's going to win and who's going to lose, right? We all want to be winners in this room. So I'm going to have a little fun here. But the losers, unfortunately, sorry, Cavs, really sad day on Tuesday. I have to tell you how happy I was on Tuesday when the Warriors won. I was like, this is going to make my presentation great. Are the enterprises that deploy technology for technology's sake. I'm sure most of you in this room have seen that. I've certainly seen where we can get overloaded in technology, tons of new vendors every day. It all sounds the same. How are we going to apply it? So the winners, go Warriors, will be the enterprises that focus on the outcomes and the transformation. And how are we going to do that? So along with this, we're going to have to deal with analytics is going to force us to blend data where it lives. We're going to need to bring those data sources together, not in 20 minutes or 2 days from now, but right now and in the places that they currently live. At the same time, we've got the pressure of we're moving from this world of captured data where we put data into Hadoop or we put some of it in the cloud and we have a hybrid model where some of it's in the cloud and some of it's on-premise. But what's starting to emerge is, and the earlier discussions around real-time, it's going to be more about data's connected, it's fluid, it's moving. So we've got the challenges around the data, we've got the challenges of a lot of technology. So I'm sure all of you at this point are probably ready to have a little bit of sugar. So I'm going to talk about sugar for a minute. So one of the biggest sugar manufacturers, distributors, is a Pentaho customer in the world. And what's fascinating about that is it's a commodity market, and you have to be able to optimize production, shift production based on supply and demand. And what they've done is they've created an entire robotic refining and processing line for sugar. They get the raw materials, it goes through this entire process. Now, the interesting thing is there's a lot of information coming off the sensors and coming off that processing line. But what makes it really difficult is sugar is different depending on the part of the world that you live in. I learned a lot about sugar. I didn't know these things. But if you live in Peru, for instance, and you're a kid and you eat a cupcake, it's going to taste far sweeter to you than a kid who lives in the United States. So what they were challenged with is, we've got these efficiencies in terms of the refining process and the distribution, but how do we adjust for the sugar quality? Because if the sugar gets there and it doesn't taste the way it's supposed to taste, we've got a big problem on our hands. only when they were able to bring in the data from what type of raw materials are we dealing with? Where is that sugar coming from? What's the sugar concentration? What's the best shipping route? All of these additional data sources, along with that sensor data, is really what was able to allow them to compete in a very commodity global market. It's important to think about that because we're going to hear a lot about machines and sensor data and how fascinating it is in capturing it. But only with the context of that additional data are we really going to see those business outcomes. Another example, just to kind of give you a sense of what that context looks like, Caterpillar. So Caterpillar Marine Asset was managing ships fleets of ships for the U.S. Navy for many years, and they were able to collect data from ships, determine if a part was going to go down. They could bring in some operational data that said, where's that part available, get it out to that ship in the Indian Ocean so they didn't have any problems, get it fixed, everybody's up and running again. And that's kind of the initial sort of business outcomes they were driving towards with the sensor data. So in the last couple years, being shipping is, again, a thin margin business, they said, well, let's look at maintenance costs. And what could we do with maintenance costs to reduce those costs over time? And so what they started to do is they looked at information that was coming off the sensors, and they said, well, we clean the ships 2 times a year. Maybe we could reduce that. Let's see if we could reduce the amount of times a year we have to clean the hulls of the ship. Well, what they found is when they started to bring in information about fuel consumption, about the drag on the ships, about the actual angles of the hulls of these ships, they realized that over time, ships accumulate a massive amount of barnacles. And those barnacles create a gigantic drag. And if they could clean them 4 times a year, they actually would save $10 million over 2 years for a fleet of only 8 ships. So you can do the math there and think about how all of that additional data really brought the value to that picture in terms of the sensor data. Another example is a customer who is a leader in connected car technology. So they're the guys that put the, you know, are able to put the dongle in your car and track your driving. And so what they've done is they've taken that data and they allow insurers to do usage-based insurance. What's your driving pattern like? Well, it's kind of interesting to know that, you know, Donna sometimes goes 80, sometimes she goes 40, sometimes when she's in San Jose, she does a U-turn where she's not supposed to because she's crazy downtown. But all these things are kind of interesting in and of themselves. But what really makes it interesting for the insurers is when they could start to bring in, where are you? What does the terrain look like that you drive on? What's the weather like? What kind of customer have you been? Are you a really good customer? Have you been there for, you know, 20 years? Once they could provide that context of data with their telemetry, that's where the insurers start to see massive savings in terms of managing risk, retaining and attaining customers. We all would feel better if our 17-year-old's policy didn't have to be a ridiculous amount a month if they were a good driver, as some kids are. So really interesting story about how that context of the additional data is what brings the value in this IoT use case. And the last one is Hitachi Rail Europe. And this is one that, if you want to take it to the extreme in terms of transformation, is really all about the context of the data. So this is a long project. It's going to be probably more than 10 years. And what Hitachi Rail is doing is saying, hey, we're not going to sell trains anymore to cities. Nobody wants to do that. We're going to actually offer trains as a service. So what does that mean in terms of when you have to deliver the service? Every time the train goes down, you don't get paid. And so in the initial phases of this, what they're looking at, of course, is how do we reduce costs? They know that doors tend to jam. And if the doors jam, they've got a problem on their hands. So they need to be able to predict when those doors are going to fail and make sure that they can have them fixed, pull the train off the line before that happens. Now, going beyond that, they also know that the more optimized they can make those routes, the better. So as they're starting to be able to predict failure, they can also determine how much more efficient can we be in terms of having the trains be on time? So really great example of how IoT and the sensor data with the context of big data is driving value. So in summary, IoT is very exciting. There's a ton of technology. I have a board in my office that shows all the technology companies that are emerging in IoT, and it's fascinating. But what we're going to have to do is, much like we did in the early days of big data, it's not about the technology, it's about the outcomes. And until we can figure out what those business outcomes are, we won't know how to apply the right technologies. The other thing is, we're going to have to be able to blend that machine-generated data with the other data sources in our organizations. If we can't do that, it's going to be really difficult to see the kind of outcomes that I talked about today. And lastly, we're going to have to focus on those transformational business outcomes and interoperate and leverage the multiple data sources we have today. So an open type environment is going to be really important. So thank you so much for your time. If you'd like to stop by, I'd love to talk to you more about some of what customers are doing with IoT and sensor data. And come by our booth, and we've got a great demo we can show you as well. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Donna.
Thank you. All right.
I might say that was a sweet presentation. Okay. So it was also a little bit controversial because our next presenter is actually from Cleveland, so he was not too happy about the trophy and the gloating and everything right there. So hopefully I don't hear anything going on backstage there. Anyway, our next presenter, first data job was he was a human intel analyst for the military. Served two tours of duty, one in Iraq and one in Somalia, so a veteran, so we definitely thank him for that. And the fun fact, which I thought was really cool, particularly because I'm a coffee drinker, is he's a master roaster. And he actually has his own company, Tame Rabbit. So you can look at it, tamerabbit.com. So very pleased to bring up our next presenter, Tim Leonard, to power us through the final presentation. Tim?
All right,
there you go.
Appreciate that. Well, I got to tell you, I gave LeBron a call before he came out, and I said, listen, LeBron, I have a chance to bring home a trophy that I know that we can bring back to Cleveland. And so Hortonworks presented us the Innovator of the Year Award, so we let you guys have the trophy here, so just make sure. NBA trophy versus Data Summit Award, we took that. So I'm going to cover a great topic. As a customer of Hortonworks, one of the best things I have is to be able to talk a little bit about success stories. This is a success story that I'm going to present to you guys that enabled us to look at something that we had thought was, and I tried not to use disruption, so I apologize if it sneaks it in there. So when we set out for at TMW Systems, which is the largest ERP carrier, transportation ERP system in the industry today, TMW has the ERP system, has well over 4,000 carriers, trucking carriers. Hopefully you see a correlation between what George presented and what you're seeing here. A lot of the same technology got play inside of TMW. We also have Appian, which is a route optimization capability and the largest data lake in transportation today. So what I'm going to talk about was the abilities to actually look at trucking. Trucking is unique in a way that it was a very fragmented industry. There's a lot of different scenarios within trucking that we felt we wanted to provide an opportunity to evolve the business. And one of the things that on the evolution part of the trucking transportation, we started looking at the data. We started collecting it from thousands of our carriers to bring it in and kind of look at different avenues of approach. What you see up there is the domain expertise, the freight volume, pricing advantages. Those were things that made trucking companies very successful. However, on the flip side, we looked at opportunities to solve a problem around a very little market-wide data availability. People couldn't see the entire market, whether it's in North America, Europe, Australia. TMW expanded the globe. The other thing was every single fleet that was out there had secret sauce. They had their own special way of analyzing data, doing route optimization. And the last point is it seemed like the people who never owned the assets in trucking had the best data points. What started coming out of the data, however, is, as most of you don't know or know, the trucking industry is really unique. It's unique in a way that 95% of the trucking industry is actually the small carriers, 50 or less. And really only 5% of the entire industry is there. And so the daunting deficit of data available to the small carriers was tremendous. So the primary thing that we wanted to look at was what's causing these small carriers' problems, and then what evolutional component could we evolve into this industry? And you can see the thing is, they were guessing at price points. They would guess at data things to pick up freight, move the freight, what's inside the freight, the ability to hit the best route going through, whether using ALK or Appian. So the low pricing capabilities was there. So the other thing that we notice is that no matter what freight you're in or what size fleet that you're in, the data anomalies were always the same. Things around miles, the weight of the vehicles, different maintenance capabilities. We have a great maintenance system that we can check all the parts, the capabilities off that. So as we're looking at that, we also notice that the lanes within the system. So we had this great hypothesis. We then started working with Hortonworks. I had just left General Motors, working on the big data strategy. Before that, I was at Dell. And so looking at the various techniques out there, I knew that who I wanted to partner up with was Hortonworks. So I sat down with some of their experts. George certainly is one of them. And we started looking at what's the value of the data pieces? What are the things that are most important to us? Once again, the evolution piece of this thing came into play. What came out of it was something entirely different. One of the things that we came out was the revolutionary pieces of the data, what it showed us. The things that it showed us is TMW had a unique position in the field to create what's called a market rate index. The abilities for everybody, whether you're small, large, or medium, to have a central location to come to be able to compare capabilities. So we looked at things like the national rate index off of historical points, fuel surcharges, maintenance costs, every type of possible condition that you could look at in terms of all the freights and all the fleets that were out there. And why was that important? So as we're starting to look at why that is so important is the small businesses were starting to go out at a fast rate. So our first thing was to work with Hortonworks and actually put in what we call a data visualization capability to take data that we have from all this information, whether it was their ERP systems, their telematics, their business intelligence tools, and actually create a customized low-end in the cloud utilizing an Azure environment. What was so unique about this is the technical pieces around this, and I'll talk a little bit, since I have a breakout class tomorrow around the hive conditions, actually started looking at our experts within our data field actually would create over 30 different star schema designs. And so we invented what's called wide table analytics. We no longer put out star schema capabilities. With the Hadoop structure and the Hive configuration, we actually put in wide table analytics that enable you to ask not the questions, the what if questions, but the what are questions, the abilities to fill the gap around there in a low cost structure, a tenant capabilities, utilizing Knox Ranger to be able to do the security module, and then the product around Atlas that enabled us to do the governance pieces of it. So that was our first implementation. So what quickly evolved is we now have close to 400 to 450 carriers inside of the market rate index. And you may say, well, that's a low number. That's close to 750,000 cabs, trucks that are on the road today. The other aspect of it is that the abilities to partner within Trimble bought TMW, within that is actually start evolving our technology with our telematics provider, which is PeopleNet. So the combination of the abilities to get into our customers, actually solve it for the small businesses, is we actually started getting into a better data science capability. So we started playing a little bit around, as George had talked about, in terms of the streaming processes on real-time capabilities, but more importantly, the Spark machine learning libraries. So as we started evolving around the machine learning libraries, we started knowing anomalies around the finance areas, which we control in the back office. The fuel, inside of trucking today, if you could save a small carrier 2 to 3 cents, even if they're idling their truck, it literally moves their operating income by several points. So those are the things that we knew that by creating this market rate index, this data lake that is now become the largest in transportation, we can actually pull in at any type of data source. Here's the thing that most people don't know about. So yes, TMW has the relationship with the carriers. We can pull from the trucks themselves, the sensor data. But we didn't stop there. So with Trimble's help, farming data, agriculture data, geospacing data, data sensor data in the roads. Every DOT has shared data that's out there. So we started pulling all that data in to actually help and look at all the pieces of questions that we weren't asking. So the last step that we had looked at was, okay, that still wasn't enough. Something was here that we were missing. So we started working with some of the smaller carriers of the features around looking at the data that's available, feeding it in there. But what we came out with is the ability to create a tenant structure model. So when you're looking at something like going to Atlanta and you're a small trucking company versus one of the big ones, you don't know if you're going to deadhead coming in. Most of the deadheading is as you're leaving the point that you dropped off freight, I'm not going to build any freight anymore. So in the history of transportation, deadheading existed mostly around the states. It wasn't down to the zip code level. So the first time ever, we are able to share with the small carriers the opportunities to actually deadhead in a certain region. And that enabled them to accept freight or not accept freight or adjust their rates as they're coming forward. So here's what I want to conclude with. So as we're looking at the evolution of helping individuals out, generating better revenue, looking at getting the best rate optimizations in terms of what they're going to go do, we quickly discovered that we're starting to change the industry. We quickly changed the industry around the small carriers. So through the data lake and through the work with Hortonworks and the opportunities to actually provide the examples, for example, that George shared this morning, we're actually able to give tools back into people that couldn't afford the tools at a low cost structure. So now they're able to look at things like average rate, minimum rate across the entire industry. So if you can imagine going into a portal, looking at 750,000 trucks across the United States and Canada, and actually understanding that if I go and try to penetrate into Dallas, Texas, what will my cost be around these particular things? Will my fuel charge be at a mile that I'm not willing to accept freight at a certain rate? Geographical levels in terms of trying to understand is what's the maintenance cost in order to accept that? So which gives them the abilities for a couple things. Negotiate better rate structures with the shippers. Shippers and the carriers are kind of like two confrontational disadvantages, advantages based on who you talk to. By marrying those two together, the carriers and the shippers, and providing data visibility to them, that's actually helped us grow the relationship and actually change it for the small players. Identify those lanes in a network that can easily bear a rate increase. That was really important. Nobody knows the structure around the rate opportunities. And so for the first time ever, not only can you see it with your own secret sauce, you now have the abilities in the data lake to go in there and log it and compare it to the industry itself. And the last ones, quote, new business wins that weren't there before. So the opportunities to look at new rate opportunities, to look at the new rate structures, actually enabled people not only to say no to people that would just drive through home like a shipper, but also the abilities to kind of go into other markets, things around reefer, things around van, flatbed, and also other lines of business like intermodal, working with shipping companies or rail companies, which TMW looks at all shipping carriers. It doesn't make a difference, intermodal, rail systems. So those are the things is that, is my rate beneficial for me? And then the last thing is reallocate internal resources to really work on profitable lanes. And that was key. So when you're looking at a small trucking company, Aunt Sally does the spreadsheet, Uncle George does the maintenance. So the abilities for a small trucking company with one person to be able to actually change his job thing and actually work on what makes that family's business more profitable was a huge win for us. So that enables us to actually come in, do the jobs that they were doing, and actually free them up to actually help generate money for the family. And this is what I want to conclude with. So most of us at TMW set out to evolve the existing data problem in the industry itself. What we came away with was a whole new factor. We revolutionized the way that we can make the level and playing fields for small carriers equal to the large carriers that are out there, the Amazons of the world that are trying to actually get back into the small pieces. So that was the benefit that we saw, and it actually enabled us to provide something that no one else has ever done. So thank you very much. Appreciate to be able to talk to you guys this morning. Have a more technical in-depth on this Thursday. And so I appreciate everybody, and thank you very much. Have a great day.
Thank you. Thank you. All right. All right, Tim finishes it off strong there. Okay, great presentation. I love that story. And we've had a great day. We did push the poll. The app is back up, so I'm going to try again. Glutton for Punishment. It's in there. Some of you have answered it. So if you scroll down, there's been quite a few updates. But if you look in the app, we do have the question and a polling question. I'm going to tell you that just now. So actually, here it is. Thank you. So the polling question, how many of you are using streaming data? So we heard lots of stories today. Both the tech, saw a great demo, and some real use cases around streaming data, really transformative here in the case of TMW, and the way that they've been interacting with their business, and you know, likewise with Pinsight Media and others. So great stories. Take a second to answer the question, investigating the potential, just started using, deep experience, and not relevant. So take just 1 second for me. Hopefully the app will stay up for me this time, and we'll be able to get some answers. Let's go ahead and look at the results. So, oh good. So that's actually 105. It's not one. It's actually 108, 9, good. So we're getting results. But we can see what the results are. Quite a few people are just investigating, almost half, a little more than half, investigating. Many are at the early stages, not too many with deep experience. I think that kind of goes to some of the presentations we saw yesterday in terms of data science and making data science and democratizing it, making it a little bit more easy for organizations to adapt, and then few of you who's not relevant. We're actually up to almost 150 responses. So I appreciate that. Continue to respond. I'll look at that, and we'll use that data, and we definitely appreciate it. So let's go ahead and go to our next slide. There we go. Okay, so just a quick reminders, and then we'll get going. Passport competition. Many of you visited the sponsors in the exhibit area to enter the contest, but I want to make sure that you take the time to do that, to get into the contest. You still have time to visit all of the booths with that poster that's being displayed to get a chance to win those very sweet headphones. And finishing off just with the rest of the day for everybody, what are we going to see? We've got the community showcase, which is open right now. We're going to go into a quick break. A couple things I want to point out. The format's more or less the same, but importantly, the Apache NiFi crash course, you want to make sure that you go to that early if you want to take advantage of it, because it is first come, first serve. And then there's a data science crash course in the afternoon. And then importantly, the IBM meetup. And then one final plug for tomorrow. I want to make sure you all are enticed and teased to come back for the keynotes in the morning. We're going to have a Hadoop 3.0 demo. So I don't think we talked it up enough. It is a chance to hear about the directions and what's happening with the very latest in the core platform. We're going to both hear about those core directions from Arun Murthy, so one of the founders of Hortonworks, and we're going to see a demo of some of the new capabilities in that. So with that, I'll thank you and go and have a great day. Thanks very much.
Ziggy Iggs. I got one more problem with your girl. Hey.